So good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank Dr. Verma for this session. I think retinal vein occlusions is the second most common, or maybe the third most common disease we see nowadays in the clinic after diabetic maculopathy or AMD. And the problem with all of these diseases is that they are very recurrent and take up a lot of time in our work. So this is a patient who has central retinal vein occlusion, and they come with sudden vision loss. The primary thing that needs management in such a patient is only the edema. Even when we have an ischemic retinal vein occlusion where we need to treat the neovascularization on the disc and progression to NVG with PRP, even in these patients, there can be a severe macular edema which needs to be addressed. So when we see a patient of retinal vein occlusion, the first thing we have to see is what are the risk factors and try to address them. Most commonly, almost in 90% of the patients, it is systemic hypertension. Many times patient is not aware that he's a hypertensive, so I always keep a BP instrument in my room and get it checked. And many times it is high, but the patient not aware. And then you have to write to the physician to manage it better. These are the other risk factors: hyperlipidemia, diabetes. And a very important ocular risk factor is coexisting glaucoma, primary glaucoma, which again the patient may not be aware of. So we have to take a second look at the optic nerve head in RVO patients. In a young patient who's less than 40, 42 years of age, very commonly there is no reason for the vein occlusion, CRVO, and it's believed to be an idiopathic inflammation, though sometimes it can be secondary to SLE or sarcoidosis. But very important cause, especially if you see bilateral vein occlusion in a young patient, is blood dyscrasia. So CBP is the most important test to request for in a young patient. CBP meaning the blood picture or the counts. Hyperhomocysteinemia, not so common. But the treatment for the vein occlusion, even in the young, remains the same, which is intravitreal injections. So why does macular edema happen? It's primarily because of the hypoxia leading to inflammatory mediator release as well as VEGF release. And both these chemicals causing increased vascular permeability and increased blood flow leading to edema. So it automatically follows that treatment will involve addressing these two agents, which is steroids or anti-VEGFs. And this is the anti-VEGFs available to us, and these are the steroids available to us. So generally, when we first see a patient of CRVO, very often there is a history of glaucoma, or you can detect it for the first time. Hypertension, same thing. And what you do is you give an injection. The primarily at the first visit is a macular edema management, but you also have to educate the patient about progression to ischemic form and neovascular glaucoma, and to report symptoms of pain, redness, etc. So when we generally give an injection in the clinic at the first visit itself, and the patient has a good result. And generally they will come back every 2 months or 3 months with a recurrence. And this is how it goes. This patient received 8 injections in 2 years. And then he underwent cataract surgery. And after that, we shifted to steroid to reduce the cost and number of injections. And now his recurrences are every 5 months, not every 2 months. And he's still going strong on 5 monthly injections, good vision. And this has been for many years. Same thing goes with BRVO, branch vein occlusion, but they generally respond for a longer time, less recurrences, and a good visual, better visual prognosis than CRVO. So hemiretinal vein occlusion is something which is intermediate to these two entities. In 20% of the patients, there is an anatomic variation where the CRVO, the central retinal vein, gets split into two behind the optic nerve head, and its clinical features and complications are intermediate to those of the other two entities. And the macular edema has to be managed as in BRVO, which really means that additional laser is also recommended in addition to the injections. So this is a summary of all the major studies done on retinal vein occlusion, primarily CRVO. These two studies were done with ranibizumab or Lucentis. Galileo was done with Eylea or aflibercept. And these two are with steroids, this one with Ozurdex, and this is with triamcinolone injection, all of them showing significant visual improvement with injections. So this is the latest study which has been done with the aflibercept. And in this, monthly injections were given for the first 6 months and then PRN for the next, till the end of 1 year, and showing remarkable visual improvement on treatment. These two, Copernicus and Galileo, are both with aflibercept. And the important thing to see is that even when they shifted to PRN dosing during the last 6 months, the visual results achieved in the first 6 months with monthly dosing were maintained. So PRN dosing is also acceptable. The time to first good visual improvement seems to be 4 to 5 months of monthly injections. You get the best possible visual improvement. Very important is timing of treatment, when to treat. These studies with ranibizumab showed that if you treat 6 months after the patient has presented, you get a good OCT picture, there is anatomic success, but the visual outcome is not equal to if they had been treated right in the first visit. So treatment should be immediately after the diagnosis to get the best vision gains. Now the follow-up, long-term follow-up. This was a trial of the same Cruz and Bravo studies done with ranibizumab, 12 months after the patients were enrolled. And what did they find? That in the second year, if you reduce the review and treatment to 3 months, every 3 months, universally, the patients with who had CRVO, they started losing vision in the second year. So in the second year, the review and injections should be individualized, depending on the case, how severe it is. And CRVO may need more frequent follow-up and injections than every 3 months, even in the second year. Though BRVO may remain stable with less frequent review and injections. And in a vitrectomized eye, which is not an uncommon situation nowadays, if you have to treat, which is the drug of choice? Well, Avastin and Lucentis did not give a dry macula even at 1 week after injection. But the aflibercept was able to keep the macula dry for 5 weeks and steroid for 7 weeks. So these are your choices in a vitrectomized eye. And this was a very old study done with triamcinolone, finding definite benefit with injection of steroid versus no treatment. Of course, the rate of IOP rise and cataract was higher in the 4 mg group, and so it recommended a 1 mg injection to reduce the side effects. A more recent study with the Ozurdex implant, finding that though there is excellent visual improvement at 2 to 3 months, it comes to baseline by 6 months, requiring a re-injection. And same thing for the OCT, at 3 months you have a good result. The CME, the macular thickness reduction is maximum, but by 6th month it is equal to no treatment. Now one thing which comes to mind very importantly is which one to choose when you're seeing a patient. So there are no comparisons done as yet in a good randomized trial. However, the various studies, if you see the various reports and try to analyze them, it seems that there is a trend for anti-VEGFs achieving better visual results than Ozurdex or dexamethasone. And then there are different studies which show that there are no differences between the two, but the universally found that with the steroid you need lesser injections and there are more adverse effects in terms of raised IOP or cataract. Laser for macular edema in CRVO is not recommended because it doesn't give visual benefit, though your macular thickness may reduce. So for CRVO, prompt injection, which could be anti-VEGF or steroid, which could be monthly or as needed. And for BRVO, the only additional recommendation comes from the old BRVO study group, which shows that macular laser should be done at 3 months when the hemorrhages have resolved, if the vision is less than 20 by 40 and you get a good long-term improvement versus no laser group. So, of course, there's an angiogram required before you do the laser to direct your laser. So for BRVO or hemiretinal vein occlusion, prompt injection, and once the macular thickness has reduced, modified macular grid laser. Thank you.